Previously on Elements of Justice.
The source of the anonymous tip and the location of the remaining suit of armor, the one belonging to the victim that died at the statue. Sonata should be out investigating those things right now.
Miss Sweetievale has decided to exercise her right to remain silent.
You testified that you decided to move the body after you killed Royal Order, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Objection!
The letter opener was not used to kill Royal Order. It's just a fabricated piece of evidence used to support Sugar Stamp's story. Her confession is a complete and utter fabrication in and of itself. One pony in particular would have had access to the scene. And by having access, they would have had the chance to bring the helmet there to plant it, all in order to support Sugar Stamp's testimony. Private Eye!
Gah!
Hold it!
Private Eye must have known of Sugar's guilt, but aside from her confession, he did not have the right amount of evidence to support it. He decided he would have to take matters into his own hooves.
It's true. I confess.
No more secrets. It's time we finally heard Sweetie's side of the story, and if she won't cooperate willingly, I'll make her. The defense would like to step down from defending Sweetie Belle.
Athena?
You can't just step down now!
If Sweetie Belle is willing to testify, then I'll remain as her defense.
Fine! I'll do it! I'll testify. And hope you don't regret it.
Threatening to step down as Sweetie Belle's lawyer? You must have scared her half to death!
Yeah, I probably did. But I had to. Sweetie Belle wasn't going to talk unless she was backed into a corner.
It's true. She was awfully determined to keep things to herself. Again.
Yeah, again. What's her angle here?
I'm wondering if that was connected to how she was behaving earlier today.
Earlier today? You mean before the trial?
Yeah, and how nonchalant she was. Since Athena managed to surprise her, I think she must have been counting on not being asked to testify.
Even so, don't you think it was going way too far making that threat?
Truthfully, Trucy, I didn't like doing it either. But Sweetie Belle left us no choice.
Agreed. I didn't like making Sweetie Belle feel that way either. But she's definitely up to something. We can't save her if she isn't willing to speak.
Especially if her not saying anything only implicates her even further.
Yeah, I know. I guess it just threw me for a loop.
Yeah, me too. Rarity didn't take it very well either. I'm surprised she isn't here right now.
I can't really say I blame her. Athena just put her own sister's life on the line.
Rarity and Trucy weren't the only ones thrown for a loop, though. Prosecutor Luna was as well, and for some reason, so were Miss Devotion and Miss Stamp. Could that mean...
Sounds like you finally noticed it, boss.
Hmm? Noticed what?
Trucy, did you find it odd how fair Devotion was acting? The way she handled Sugar Stamp and Private Eye? She managed to explain away the contradictions in both their testimonies. And not only that, the two of them went along with it.
Daddy! You're not saying...
This is exactly why I didn't do as Luna suggested, and go after Fair Devotion. Fair's been planning some kind of story, I think, from the very beginning. And those two, Sugar Stamp and Private Eye, somehow they're also a part of it. Probably as collaborators.
What do you mean a story? Fair and Sugar are caught up in a love triangle over Royal Order, aren't they?
That's certainly what the evidence suggests, but I'm not so sure about that anymore, Trucy. Think about it. If the writing in the journal is fake, then who's to say the love letter isn't as well?
But why would you think that?
Because of what I've been hearing. Fair and Sugar certainly act like two scorned lovers, but the emotions in their voices don't match what they're saying. In fact, their outbursts are completely emotionless, almost as if...
they don't have any real investment in what they're saying?
Exactly. That led me to believe Sugarstamp's confession was most definitely a lie. One that someone supported by planting that letter opener.
And your main suspect was Private Eye, seeing as how he was the lead investigator.
I didn't want to believe it, but it made the most sense. He was also friends with Royal Order, so he may have a personal stake in this as well. Anyway, if Sugar's lying about killing him, she must also be lying about why she killed him. Coupled with a lack of emotions regarding the subject, the affair is also likely to be a lie.
One that Fair Devotion, Sugar Stamp, and Private Eye must all be aware of. That's why you insisted we go down this route, isn't it?
It started as a hunch, but yeah, it looks like everyone's lying to us. Sweetie Belle included, for some reason.
But they must be lying for more than just trying to land Sugar Stamp in prison. So what's their endgame?
What indeed?
Hello, everyone.
Sonata!
Oh? You all seem lost in thought. Is now a bad time?
Actually, we're in recess right now, so you couldn't have picked a better time. How was your investigation?
It was quite productive. I managed to acquire the information you asked for, Athena.
Really? That's great! Let's see what you've got!
First, I managed to test the blood that Apollo, Trucy, and I found on the trees the other day. As was expected, it belonged to Royal Order.
More of his blood, huh? Should have seen that coming.
But what was it doing on the trees, though? And how did it get there? I don't recall seeing any blood on the forest floor.
I'm still not sure of that myself. The answer may come about during the rest of the trial.
Agreed. What else have you got?
Unfortunately, I wasn't able to determine the exact source of the anonymous tip, but I was able to verify which magazine was used to make it.
And that would be...
the one you found in Diamond Tiara's bedroom, Mr. Wright. It had letters cut out of it that matched the ones on the anonymous tip. I even managed to take a better quality photo of the magazine before removing it for examination.
Well, not all of us can afford a higher quality camera.
Perhaps you should learn to invest a bit more wisely then?
Don't bother, Sonata. Daddy would just be confused anyway.
What's all this stuff underneath the magazine?
I noticed that as well. After I took that picture, I did some digging and determined that's a couple of Hearts and Hooves Day envelopes. They were most likely thrown away after Ms. Tiara opened them.
Digging in a literal sense? I see you've also taken up the habit of sifting through trash, huh, Sonata?
Really, Mr. Wright? You and I both know this was part of an intense investigation. It's not sifting through trash, it's sifting through evidence.
But the fact that the magazine cutouts match the tip, does that mean Diamond Tiara is the one who actually sent it?
I'm not so sure of that, Princess Twilight. Still, it would be worth verifying for ourselves, which is why after I was done investigating, I asked her and Silverspoon to come and wait in the lobby.
That sounds like a good idea. Thank you, Sonata. What else were you able to uncover?
You remember the remaining suit of armor? I managed to find it.
You mean the one that the clone Scootaloo crashed into would have been wearing?
Precisely. I found it deep in the Everfree Forest. It had been chewed apart by timberwolves and was missing its helmet. In addition, I noticed that the left side of the body plate had a particularly ugly dent in it.
Any idea as to what made it?
Based on how it was dented and the shape of the impression left over, I'd say some kind of long wedged object.
A long wedged object?
You managed to uncover quite a bit, Sonata. It must have taken you some time.
Actually, that's the thing, Princess Twilight. It really didn't. I managed to uncover everything just this morning, while the trial was happening.
Well, maybe you're just really good at getting the job done.
You think so? Well, perhaps. But that does make me wonder.
Wonder what?
I was able to uncover all of this rather easily, without having to jump through a bunch of hoops and hurdles. So how come the investigation team managed to miss the blood and the armor entirely?
It was because of Private Eye.
What? Private Eye? I see. But that doesn't seem like him to do that. Not even if he believed, truly, that Sugar Stamp was the killer.
Have you worked with him before?
Yes, on a number of occasions. But that's neither here nor there at the moment. The point is, I trust him. I can't imagine he'd do something like that without a good reason.
But he's already admitted to forging evidence, so we know that he managed to manipulate the investigation to stay away from those other areas for some reason. If it isn't for what we uncovered, then I don't know what else.
Pardon me for my intrusion, but I must admit my own confusion.
What? Zora?
Oh, yes. That was another thing Athena asked me to do. Bring Zecora along.
Right. Thank you for coming, Zecora. I just have a few last-minute questions that I need you to answer.
If aid from me is what you desire, then by all means, you may inquire.
Sonata, could you show her that photo? The one with the boulder outside of the mirror pool?
Here it is.
Zecora, this photo shows the boulder that was placed outside of the mirror pool. There are a couple of flowers all over it. Can you tell me what they are?
Of their identity, I have no doubt. These are day bloomers with petals out.
Day bloomers.
Right. That's what I was thinking. Sonata, do you have that other photo I requested?
Yes. Here you are, Athena.
Athena? That's just a photo of inside Zecora's home. I'm pretty sure she recognized that.
It's not the inside of the hut I'm interested in, actually. It's the healing potion inside that was stolen. First, I want to reaffirm that the potion was stored in the floor shelf, right?
Yes, that is where it was always stored, just above the hut's floorboard.
And this potion, is it difficult to make?
Even with my skill, it requires some time. The components are not simply found for a dime. There's also a considerable time to brew. It can take upwards of a full month or two.
Do you just make these kinds of potions for yourself?
Thanks to their rarity, the demand is quite high. This one the local hospital will always buy. Its potency proves to be worth the price, when normal treatments won't suffice.
Local hospital. That must mean Ponyville General Hospital.
That answers everything I had for now. Thanks again, Zecora. Could you actually stick around before the trial begins? I might want to ask a few more things.
Of course. I'll gladly spare my time, if it will help solve this awful crime.
I know you didn't ask this of me, Athena, but I'd also gone to check up on the Carousel Boutique break-in.
Oh, good thinking. Did you find anything new?
Unfortunately, no. The investigators are still looking for anything that might have been taken, but so far they've found nothing. Rarity, as you can understand, is still quite upset.
Yeah, I can imagine. Although, if nothing's missing, could that mean that if anything was stolen at all, it was something no one would even notice in the first place?
Miss Cykes?
Turning page! I'm surprised to see you. What brings you to the courthouse?
I...
I just wanted to say good luck. We're all counting on you to free Miss Sweetie Belle.
I know, Turning. So long as Sweetie Belle cooperates with us, we'll be able to succeed.
I also wanted to see Scootaloo again, to check how she's feeling.
I'm doing okay, Turning. I have faith that Athena and Twilight are going to turn this trial around.
Yeah, me too.
There's something up with him. It's not just trial jitters. What could it be? Maybe... Hey, Turning.
Yes, Miss Cykes?
It's about your mother. Is she... okay?
Okay?
I mean, she's been acting a bit strangely all throughout this trial. You wouldn't happen to know why that is, would you?
Can I ask you to do something, Miss Cykes? Whatever happens in this trial, please help my mom, no matter the cost.
What the... Help his mom? No matter what the cost? What could that mean? And why does it fill me with the most ominous sense of dread?
May I have your attention, please? The trial is about to reconvene. Defense, please return to the courtroom shortly.
Right. We'd better head inside, Athena.
Just a second. I want to ask Sakura and Scootaloo one more thing.
Huh? What is it, Athena?
It just occurred to me. All throughout this trial, we've been hearing about these clanging noises. But Scootaloo, during your testimony yesterday, you never mentioned anything about them. Did you hear anything of that sort that night?
Yeah, actually. I heard one when I was just passing by Sakara's house, and then one more just before I crashed into Royal Order.
So you heard two? And Sakura, you still maintain you heard just the one?
I am quite sure of that amount. No other clangs I can recount.
Defense! You need to head inside!
Just one more question, Scootaloo. That first clang you heard, did it differ in any way from the second one?
I guess a little? Like, the first one was much louder than the other one. They were both metallic sounding.
Louder, huh? Then that would mean...
Speaking of crashing into Royal Order, I'm not sure what it means, but you said he was wearing armor?
He should have been, yeah. That's what Sweetie used to scare away the Timberwolves.
But he wasn't wearing any armor when I crashed into him.
He wasn't? But then how?
Defense!
Athena, we need to get going!
Right. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you after the trial.
Court is back in session for the trial of Miss Sweetie Belle. I trust that the defendant is ready to testify?
Yes, Your Honor.
Before we begin, I would like to ask if either the prosecution or defense have any final objections to the matter. Prosecutor Luna, what say you?
Having Sweetie Belle testify must have thrown her entire plan for a loop.
Prosecutor Luna, you appear somewhat hesitant.
Those eyes of yours have not dwindled with age, Your Honor. To be perfectly frank, I am a bit hesitant. I cannot foresee where exactly this testimony will lead us.
Prosecutor Luna?
Yes, Miss Cykes?
Do you remember what you told me last night?
But still... I believe you must, if nothing else, trust that in the end, the truth will be found. Never mind what the lawkeeper has said.
I know, but it's hard sometimes. Like stumbling around in the dark hoping you'll find a light switch. Except you don't know if the room you're in even has one.
Trust is a leap of faith, Athena. That's all it ever is. I do. Yes.
You trusted me back then. Asked me to find the truth in any way I can. Please, trust me now.
I shall then, Miss Cykes.
I'd ask you to trust me as well, Sweetie Belle, but I somehow doubt you will.
Your Honor, the prosecution is ready to hear the witness's testimony.
As is the defense.
Very well. Witness, you will testify to the court as to your movements on the night of the murder.
There isn't really a lot to say. That night, I was at the Statue of Nightmare Moon. Not long after I'd arrived, I saw Timberwolves approaching the area. One of them attacked me! I managed to scare it off, and afterwards, I hid behind the statue. I was there for a long time. I don't really remember for how long exactly. It's all a bit of a blur. After a while, I left the statue seeing that no one was around. I made myself a tourniquet and went to Zakora's hut to look for a healing potion.
Wait a moment! You mean to say, you were almost killed that night by wild timberwolves?
Yeah.
My word! I knew those animals were brutes, but I never imagined they'd go so far as to attack a random filly! To think there could be a place so full of danger in this world! Let alone one so close to somewhere as idyllic as Ponyville!
Hmm? What's up with Prosecutor Luna?
It is indeed fortunate that the bell did not toll for thee, young one.
In any case, I believe we may now begin the cross-examination. Defense, are you ready?
You bet, Your Honor.
There isn't really a lot to say. That night, I was at the Statue of Nightmare Moon. Hold it!
Why were you in the Everfree Forest in the first place? And why the statue?
Do I really have to say it?
Yes, you do.
Fine! It was because I found Scootaloo's note in Carousel Boutique.
Scootaloo's note?
This one, Your Honor. It's Scootaloo's confession to Rarity for taking a roll of golden silk in order to fulfill the blackmailer's demand.
After I'd found that note, I considered following her and turning into the forest to stop them.
And why was that?
To get back the roll of golden silk, obviously! That thing cost Rarity a small fortune! And Scootaloo stole it right from under my nose! I didn't want Rarity to find out or she'd totally freak! And I didn't want Scootaloo to do anything dumb, or anything more dumb than stealing from my sister!
But how did you end up at the statue?
Once I finally decided to go after them, I headed to the forest entrance. As soon as I got there, I heard a loud noise coming from within. I thought it might be her, so I cast an illumination spell and started heading towards it.
Could you describe this noise for us?
It was loud and metallic. Like a clang.
Clang?
That noise seems to be at the center of everything. Cykora and Diamond Tiara heard one, and Silverspoon heard two.
And Scootaloo heard two as well. This must have been one of them. And if one was quieter than the other... Sweetie Belle? Around what time did you hear that cling?
Probably around 10:15. Yeah, that sounds right.
10:15. The same time that Zakora, Diamond Tiara, and Silverspoon each heard one. And when Sugar Stamp kicked Royal Order. If that confession wasn't a load of baloney, that is.
Let's get back to the testimony. Witness, what happened next?
Not long after I'd arrived, I saw timberwolves approaching the area. Hold it!
So the timberwolves were in the area when you arrived at the statue and started to approach?
Yes, that's correct.
Did you see anything else near the statue besides those timberwolves?
Yeah, actually. There was a big bloodstain out in front of the statue, and also a set of armor.
That armor, no doubt, must have belonged to the Royal Order whom Scootaloo crashed into, and who crawled to the statue afterwards.
Except she claims that that Royal Order wasn't wearing armor. So how did it get there?
And the bloodstain?
Royal Orders, of course. The blood test proved that. Sweetie Belle, was there a body present when you saw all of this?
No, there wasn't a body.
That means the Timberwolves must have already eaten the body and were in the process of leaving when Sweetie Belle came along.
Objection!
But that contradicts what Sugar Stamp said. She saw Sweetie Belle trip Royal Order. The body had not yet been eaten by Timberwolves.
Objection!
However, as Fair Devotion suggested, it's possible Sugar Stamp was misremembering things that night. She might have been so traumatized that she only thought she saw Sweetie Belle trip him.
That still leaves Miss Devotion's testimony to contradict this one. Defense, tell me you have a plan for resolving that issue.
I do, of course. Don't expect it right now, okay?
I have a lot of patience, Miss Cykes. You needn't worry.
The only way to resolve it is to disprove both Sugar's and Fair's entire testimonies, which have been definitive since they back each other up. But, in order to do that, I'll first have to break Sweetie Belle's testimony.
Witness, please continue.
One of them attacked me! I managed to scare it off, and afterwards, I hid behind the statue. Hold it!
Were you injured by this attack?
A little bit. It scratched my right foreleg, enough for me to bleed a little.
Which accounts for the fact that the witness's blood was found at the scene.
How did you scare off the Timberwolf, exactly?
It was simple, really. I used the armor to do it.
What do you mean?
Timberwolves don't like loud sounds. My friend Applebloom once told me about how her granny scared off a whole pack using nothing but a frying pan. I remembered that story and decided to do something similar with the armor. I took two pieces and hit them together as hard as I could. That did the job and scared them away.
A rather ingenious spur-of-the-moment idea.
And around what time did you hit the armor pieces together?
I'm not sure, to be honest.
Well, let's backtrack and see if we can figure it out. You heard the first clanging noise at 10:15, didn't you?
Yes, that's right.
And afterwards, you started heading towards where you thought it was coming from, the statue. How long did it take you to arrive?
Probably about 10 minutes.
Then we can reasonably assume that you arrived close to 10:25, if not on it. You then hit the armor pieces together, maybe around the same time, eliciting a loud clanging sound. Does that sound about right, Sweetie Belle?
Yeah, it makes sense to me.
So one loud clang at 10:15, and the quieter one Sweetie caused at the statue around 10:25. And afterwards, you chose to hide behind the statue. Why did you do that?
It's because I thought I heard someone coming, and I was afraid it was more animals. More timberwolves, maybe? Or a manticore? Or something worse? So I hid, using my magic to hide the blood trail that I left while walking behind the statue.
And what happened next?
I was there for a long time. I don't really remember for how long exactly. It's all a bit of a blur. Hold it!
You don't remember how long you were back there?
No, not at all.
She seems awfully calm about this whole thing. You're sure? You never saw whoever was coming your way?
Nope. To be honest, I don't even fully remember what happened after. I think I must have passed out for a little while.
Considering that you had just been attacked and were suffering some blood loss, that would indeed appear to be plausible. We can't expect you to remember how long you were out if you were truly unconscious, after all.
So you were out for a time, and then you came to. When you did you happen to see if the armor and bloodstain were still in front of the statue?
No, they were gone.
They were gone? As in, they were just missing?
Yep, but I didn't really think about it. I just wanted to get out of there.
I understand, Defendant. Let's return to when you came to, then. What did you do immediately afterwards?
After a while, I left the statue seeing that no one was around. I made myself a tourniquet and went to Zecora's hut to look for a healing potion. Objection!
Sweetie Belle, you're saying you made yourself a tourniquet, then made your way to Zecora's hut. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's what happened.
I don't think so.
What?
You made your tourniquet out of forest debris. And that, I'm afraid, would have been impossible for you.
Why is that?
Because, Your Honor, there's no blood leading from the back of the statue to the tree line.
What the?
You're right. For Sweetie Belle to have gotten any materials to make a tourniquet, she'd have to grab stuff from the tree line. But that would mean she'd be dripping blood all over the place.
So, Sweetie Belle, how do you explain that?
That's easy. I used my magic to keep the blood from falling everywhere.
You used your magic? Why?
What do you mean, why? I was bleeding!
Exactly. You were injured and bleeding. You just passed out and only had just awoken moments beforehand. Not the best condition to be using magic in. You'd probably be too rattled to be able to concentrate on making sure every drop of your blood didn't end up on the forest floor. So again, why would you bother trying?
I just used my magic to grab stuff from the tree line to make a tourniquet.
But that doesn't add up either, Sweetie Belle. You and I both know that your magic hasn't developed that much yet.
Yes, it has! I've been practicing outside of our lessons! You just haven't seen me!
Well, I can't deny that, I suppose.
See, no matter how you look at it, I made that tourniquet!
Oh? If that's the case, then you should be able to recreate it for us right now.
Recreate it?
Defense? Surely you're not asking the defendant to go back into the Everfree Forest just to grab a bunch of material? And surely you don't expect us to go in there with her?
Of course not, Your Honor. Besides, I already have some forest debris here. With the court's permission, I'd like to have Sweetie's magic nullifier removed so she can recreate for us the tourniquet she claims to have made on that night.
Agreed. Bailiff, remove the nullifier.
Go on, Sweetie Belle. Give it a try.
Then that goes there. And then that goes like that. I can't.
Forgive me, witness. I believe I misheard you. Did you say you can't make a tourniquet?
She did, Your Honor.
Then how did she make one on the night she was attacked?
She didn't. Some pony else did.
But who?
It might have been that some pony whom Sweetie Belle heard just before she passed out behind the statue. Or maybe...
Wait!
Miss Sweetie Belle?
I remember now. I didn't make a tourniquet. I just used a bunch of stuff I'd collected and pressed against my wound to stop it from bleeding.
You pressed unsanitized forest debris against an open wound and trusted it that it would keep it sealed long enough for you to reach Sakura's hut?
Yeah, I mean... I knew that her hut was a little far, but I also knew that she had some healing potions I could use.
If you knew that, does that also mean you knew where exactly she stored them?
Well,
Then could you please show the court from which cupboard you took the healing potion?
Here? This one?
I'm sorry, Sweetie Belle. That is incorrect.
It's incorrect? But how?
Because that night, Sweetie Belle was neither the one to make the tourniquet, nor the one to get the healing potion from Zecora. Some pony else did both.
But who? There was no one else at the statue.
I suspect Miss Cykes has been building up to this moment for quite some time. Well then, why don't you regale us? Who aided Miss Sweetie Belle in both of these endeavors?
The court wants an answer, so I'd better make this count. Let me think. The judge says no one else was at the statue besides Sweetie Belle. That much might be true. But there were other ponies in the forest that night. Given what we already know about this case, it stands to reason that her savior could be one of them. But it can't just be any of them. It'd have to be some pony who knows how to make a tourniquet and identify which potions were healing ones. And it can't be Zecora, since she had no idea that the potion had been used until after yesterday's trial. Which leaves us with a pony who has a fair bit of medical knowledge behind them, and who was in the forest that night. That can only mean...
Defense, have you any idea as to who this mysterious helper was?
I do, Your Honor. In fact, they're in the lobby right now, ready to testify.
And who are they?
Silver Spoon!
What?
Not only was she in the forest that night, but she's mentioned before that she has some light medical knowledge. It's not inconceivable that she might know how to make a rudimentary tourniquet.
No, wait! You can't call her to the stand!
Au contraire, Miss Sweetie Belle. The defense has that right. And besides, I am curious as to what Miss Silverspoon would have to say.
I would also like to hear from her. Bailiff, please bring in Miss Silverspoon to testify before the court. Now then, Miss Silverspoon. Wait a moment. Is that Miss Diamond Tiara? What are you doing here? Only Miss Silverspoon was summoned.
If you think I was going to let Sylvie face the courtroom alone, then you're out of your old geezer mind.
Miss Diamond Tiara was quite insistent she accompany her friend, Your Honor. Her loyalty is fairly sound.
Yes, I can see that. And her brattiness just as much.
Your Honor? Why was I asked to come back here? I already testified yesterday.
We'd like to hear once again the actions you took on the night of Royal Order's death, Silverspoon.
What? We already told you everything that happened!
Can't you just look over the court transcripts? Just save ponies like us from repeating ourselves.
Silverspoon looks like she'd rather be anywhere else but here. That must mean I'm on the right track. Diamond Tiara, it's the duty of a defense attorney to explore every possible avenue in a trial. Even if it means treading on old ground, we can't let that stop us. Not if doing so may allow us to see things a bit clearer.
A bold sentiment. I concur.
Princess Luna?
Both of you will testify as to the actions you took that night. Then we shall see if we can uncover anything new.
In other words, she's trusting that something does come out of this, and that I'm not just firing into the dark.
Fine. We'll tell you everything again. Right, DT?
Uh-huh. Oh, right. The two of us waited at the castle ruins for the CMC to show up, But it was only Scootaloo and her cult friend. He attacked me!
Afterwards, he threw DT's crown into the gorge and ran off. We tried to follow, but DT stepped on my glasses, accidentally breaking them.
That crown is one of my most prized possessions! I couldn't just leave it behind! So Sylvie and I went down the gorge to go look for it.
When we came back, though, that was when we saw the body. We were also afraid the police might find the blackmail letter, so we tried looking for it, too.
But then that zebra came, so we hid. She saw the body and ran. After a bit, we followed after her, too.
Defense?
Yes, Your Honor?
That appears to indeed be a repeat of what we heard from these fillies in yesterday's trial. I fail to see what use it may be.
There might be a hole in it, Your Honor, especially since we now have heard other testimonies besides their own.
A fair point. Very well. You may begin your cross-examination.
The two of us waited at the Castle of Ruins for the CMC to show up, but it was only Scootaloo and her cult friend. He attacked me!
Hold it! I mean, it is true that Turning Page attacked you, but, well, it wasn't like you were innocent bystanders or anything.
Right. You two were blackmailing the Cutie Mark Crusaders in order to get that roll of golden fabric.
Well, yeah! Wooden sword! Did you have any idea how painful it is? I'm lucky my nose didn't break!
I did see Mr. Wright take a hit. But something tells me he might be a bit more used to physical abuse than most.
And what happened afterward?
Afterwards, he threw DT's crown into the gorge and ran off. We tried to follow, but DT stepped on my glasses, accidentally breaking them.
That crown is one of my most prized possessions! I couldn't just leave it behind! So Sylvie and I went down the gorge to go look for it.
Hold it!
You two went down into the gorge?
Well, yeah! That stupid cult threw away my crown! I couldn't just leave it behind!
I can understand you being able to go down there, Diamond Tiara. But what about you, Silver Spoon? How do you go down there?
Well, since my glasses were broken, I couldn't see. So I needed Diamond Tiara to guide me down the steps.
Could you add that to your testimony then?
Sure. My glasses were broken, so I couldn't see. Diamond Tiara had to guide me down the steps.
Objection!
You're saying that your glasses were broken? That doesn't seem quite right to me, Silver Spoon.
Huh? But they were broken! It's just like I told you yesterday during the trial.
As I recall, Defense, you were the ones to first postulate, based on the discovery of the glass shards, that glasses were indeed broken. We even verified that the shards belonged to Miss Silver Spoon's glasses during the recess.
That is true, Prosecutor Luna. But there was a vital detail that I think you failed to mention as part of that report.
What would that be?
Those glass shards came from only one of Silver Spoon's lenses. The other was completely intact. Meaning that, with only half of her glasses broken, she could still see just fine through the other lens. If you deny that, Silver Spoon, then I'm sure you wouldn't mind if we verify with your doctor. He could easily confirm that he replaced a pair of glasses with one of the lenses broken.
No, that won't be necessary. It's true. Only one of my lenses was broken, so I could still see. Well, sort of. Enough that DT didn't have to guide me blindly down the steps, at least.
But that means that you stuck with your friend the whole time?
Yeah, of course. I was walking with only half a pair of glasses on, after all, and it was still very dark and scary. But yeah, Athena's right. I did have one lens letting me somewhat see. But I don't see how this is important at all.
Why is this detail important, Athena?
It's because not only was Silverspoon able to see while going down into the gorge, but she was also able to see coming out of it, and presumably for the rest of the night. Her being able to see at all gives a bit more credibility to my claim that she helped Sweetie Belle.
You're right! Wow, Athena, look at you! You're really managing to put the pieces together!
Thank you, Twilight. But we've still got a bit more ways to go before we can end this.
In any case, I believe it is best that we return to the witness's testimony, now that the matter about the glasses has been cleared up.
When we came back, though, that was when we saw the body. We were also afraid the police might find the blackmail letter, so we tried looking for it, too. Hold it!
You two had gone down into the gorge looking for Diamond Tiara's crown. After you found it, you left. But during that time, did anything of note occur?
Of note? I mean, we did hear that clang sound while we were looking for it.
But there wasn't just one clang heard that night, Diamond Tiara. There were, in fact, two.
Yes, we established that in the previous trial. There was the one that Sakura, Diamond Tiara, and Silverspoon heard. And then there was the one that Silverspoon alone heard. It was suggested that it might have come from inside the castle, perhaps from something falling.
Suggested, yes, but not supported. However, that's not my point. Thanks to a little help from Scootaloo, as well as what we just heard from Sweetie Belle, I think I have a pretty good explanation for why Silverspoon heard too, but Diamond Tiara did not.
Then please explain, Miss Cykes.
Before we resumed today's trial, I asked Zecora and Scootaloo about these clangs. Zecora confirmed that she heard one before she left her hut. Scootaloo said that she also heard one when she was passing by Zecora's house. But that night, she heard a second clang, just before she crashed into Royal Order at the crossroads. Now, do you remember what we just heard from Sweetie Belle? What she did in order to scare off those timber wolves?
She banged the armor pieces together, making a clanging sound.
And that was, of course, after Zecora left her hut at 10:15. Sweetie hid the pieces together at around 10:25. That's why Zecora didn't hear a second clang. She wasn't nearby.
So this second clang was heard by Miss Scootaloo and Miss Silverspoon, then?
That's right, Your Honor. But if you think about it, that shouldn't be possible.
Why is that?
Scootaloo said she heard that clang when she was at the crossroads, and that clang came from Sweetie Belle, who was at the Nightmare Moon statue. Looking at these two locations, we see they're a short distance of each other. It's not unreasonable that Scootaloo would have been able to hear it. Yet, Silverspoon said she heard the second clang as well, all the way from the other side of the forest while she was in the gorge. Now, how can that be?
You're right. That does seem implausible. But she still said she heard that clang, so then...
There's only one explanation, Your Honor. Silverspoon was not at the bottom of the gorge like she and Diamond Tiara claimed. Instead, she was close enough to the statue to have heard that second clang. Your Honor, it is the defense's belief that instead of following Diamond Tiara down the gorge, Silverspoon chased after Scootaloo and Turning Page. She made her way through the forest, all the way to the crossroads, hearing both clangs along the way. Once she got to the crossroads, she headed for the statue where she found Sweetie Belle injured and unconscious. As I said before, Silverspoon has a bit of a background in medicine, since both her parents are doctors. She would have known how to make a tourniquet out of an assortment of items. Therefore, she would have known how to treat Sweetie Belle's injury. And that explains away the issue from earlier. How Sweetie Belle, despite not knowing how to treat her wound, managed to have it treated in the first place.
Objection!
This is truly a fascinating theory, Defense. But you have yet to answer one final question regarding it. Why would she have found Sweetie Belle at all?
Prosecutor Luna? What do you mean?
I can believe that Silverspoon might have run all the way back to the crossroads. But why would she then head to the statue after getting there? Defense, give us some proof to show why she would have gone to the statue.
Gladly, Prosecutor Luna. Take that!
This is... The photo that Private Eye took revealing Royal Order's blood at the crossroads?
The very same, Your Honor. And if you'll recall, that blood led to the Nightmare Moon statue. If that blood was visible on the night in question, then Silver Spoon should have easily seen it. And that would have meant she could have followed it to the statue where she'd find Sweetie Belle. And after she did, she treated the young filly's wound using what she had available.
Miss Silverspoon?
Sylvie? What are you? Your Honor, I object!
Yes, witness? What exactly are you objecting to?
I'm objecting to what Athena said about going to the statue and helping Sweetie Belle.
You are?
Okay, I admit it. I didn't exactly go down the gorge with DT when she needed me to. Instead, I did chase after Scootaloo and Turning Page. But that's it! That's all I did. I never went near that statue, and I never helped Sweetie Belle. Not one bit!
But then how else could Sweetie Belle have gotten the help she needed for her injury? She couldn't do it on her own. And Silverspoon, you were the only one in the forest that night, sans Zecora, with the expertise needed to help her.
I don't know, Princess Twilight, but I still never did what Athena's saying I did. And it's not like she has any proof to back that up.
Athena? You're thinking of something, aren't you?
I am. I have a pretty good idea of how to show definitively that Silver Spoon did help Sweetie Belle that night. But I don't think I want to do that just yet.
What? But shouldn't we?
We should. But there's another angle in all of this that I feel needs to be established before I do that. We know that Silver Spoon's not telling the truth, and it'd be very easy to show that. But we also know Sweetie Belle's been lying to us. I think there's a way to get the both of them to confess the truth. Kill two birds with one stone. And I think if we do that, we'll be one step closer to figuring out everything.
You really think so?
Yeah. I'm more certain of it than I've ever been, Twilight.
All right, Athena. I'll follow your lead.
Defense? This witness has objected to your claim. Do you have any proof to support it?
I do, Your Honor. But I don't want to present it at this moment.
You don't want to present it? Miss Cykes, I'm afraid I don't understand.
Your Honor, there's one more detail I would like to get an explanation for from Miss Silver Spoon.
One more detail?
Miss Cykes.
Yes, Prosecutor Luna?
We have a saying here in Equestria. Be wary of those who lead you down the garden path, promising a way out through the twists and turns. So far, you have been objecting at various points during this trial, hinting, it would seem, at some larger explanation. But you have yet to provide one. Where there were clear avenues for you to exploit, you chose instead to take multiple twisting paths, stringing the court along. So I must ask, where are you taking us? Is it another garden path? And when will these many winding roads cease, allowing us clear passage?
I understand if you feel as though I've been leading us nowhere, Prosecutor Luna, but this will be the last time I take us down those winding roads. I promise.
What is this one other detail that you had in mind, Miss Cykes?
It's something that's been bothering me from the very beginning of this entire case, Your Honor. Almost as much as Royal Order's death.
The item that got Turning Page arrested.
You mean...
That's right. The anonymous tip.
This anonymous tip. You must mean the one Miss Sugar Stamp wrote and delivered. The one implicating the deceased son.
I am Prosecutor Luna. However, I think you'll find it's far too soon for us to definitively say that Miss Sugar Stamp is responsible for writing and sending it.
Why is that, Defense?
Because of this.
Another magazine?
That's right. But this isn't just an ordinary magazine. If you flip through it, you'll see that a few pages have been cut out. Before this trial began, I had a friend test those cutouts against the ones found on the anonymous tip, and she found that they were a perfect match.
A perfect match?
Where was this magazine discovered?
In the home of Diamond Tiara.
What?
Did you say Diamond Tiara? Order! Order in the court! You mean to say that Diamond Tiara is the true sender of the tip? Witness! What do you have to say for yourself?
What? I don't know! I've never even seen that magazine in my life!
Yet it was found in your house, according to the defense. Do you deny that?
No, but... I don't know anything about it!
Objection! I know this looks bad for Diamond Tiara, but, Your Honor, it's actually impossible for her to be the one who sent the tip in the first place.
Impossible? But the magazine! If it was found in her house, and if it matches the tip, then she must have sent it!
Not quite. Take a look at this photo. It's a picture of where this magazine was found, in the trash can of Diamond Tiara's bedroom.
Defense, do you mean to say that you were... digging around in some filly's trash?
Not me, my boss! But that's besides the point. Your Honor, when you look at this photo, what do you see underneath the magazine?
Hmm? Oh, why, it's a Hearts and Hooves Day envelope. How lovely.
How long did this guy stay here last time he was in Equestria? Exactly, Your Honor. That's why it's impossible for Diamond Tiara to have sent this.
I'm afraid you've lost me, Defense.
The placement of the envelope tells us it was thrown away before this magazine. That envelope could only have been thrown away on Hearts and Hooves Day, February 14th. We know that the tip was delivered on the 13th, because that was the day that Turning Page was arrested. So it doesn't make sense for the magazine to be on top of the envelope. That means it's impossible that Diamond Tiara could have sent the tip. She'd have sent it too late.
Exactly! Finally, you said something smart.
Hey! Would it kill you to be a little grateful?
I see. But then, how do we explain the fact that the magazine was found in her bedroom?
Well, it couldn't have been stashed there by the pony who said she sent it, Sugar Stamp. She'd already been arrested by the time she arrived in Ponyville.
Logically, that means the sender must be some pony who was in Diamond Tiara's bedroom. Someone who'd be able to discard the magazine while there. Miss Diamond Tiara?
What is it, Princess Luna?
Between today and yesterday, was there any pony present in your house who could have disposed of this magazine?
Witness, it is in your best interest to be honest with the court.
Well, when Sylvie came to my house yesterday, she was carrying a magazine.
DT, wait!
Then that means that Miss Silverspoon could be the true sender.
Except for one thing, Your Honor.
It was placed outside the entrance to the Ponyville police station without any pony noticing. It was around 4:45 when a pair of officers brought it in. I doubt it could have been there for long. We were unsure if it could even be trusted until we started our inquiries.
Right. and Princess Luna said you had an appointment the day after. What time did you go?
It was around 4:30. It went on for about half an hour.
The tip was delivered around 4:45 p.m. on the 13th, when Silverspoon was busy getting her glasses replaced. So you see, she couldn't have sent it.
But she still had the magazine in question. It was still used to write the tip.
If she wasn't the one to deliver it, then she might have been given it by the true author. Is that what you're thinking, Miss Cykes?
Diamond Tiara?
What now?
I know you're scared for Silver Spoon, but figuring out what we can about this magazine is crucial to helping her, even if you can't see it. Do you remember any details about Silver Spoon when she brought the magazine to your house? Anything at all?
I...
DT, please.
Please, Diamond Tiara. I know I have no right to ask this of you, but there's a way to protect Silver Spoon, and it depends on what you're able to tell us.
Okay, fine! DT, hang on! No, no, Sylvie! Just trust me, okay? I'm doing this for your sake!
Diamond?
When Sylvie came into my bedroom with the magazine, I saw that she had a small patch on her coat that was... stained red.
Stained red? With blood, I would presume?
Yeah.
So, she had been bleeding very recently. But what could have caused the injury?
There's no way. Could it really be? I think I know the answer, Your Honor.
You do?
Yes, and it has to do with something that happened yesterday, too. While we were out investigating in preparation for defending Sweetie Belle, we learned from Apple Bloom that there'd been a break-in at Carousel Boutique.
Hmm. We'd heard of that break-in earlier, too.
A break-in? Oh, dear. Has the perpetrator been found?
While the police have cordoned off the area and are conducting their own investigation, regrettably, they have not yet found the culprit.
And neither did we when we searched the boutique after hearing of the incident. But we did find some clues as to their identity. Namely, a few drops of blood. Rarity's cat, Opalescence, had attacked them. No doubt that the blood belonged to the culprit. And, coincidentally, we have on the stand some pony who, just yesterday, had also been bleeding.
Also been bleeding? Miss Cykes, are you saying?
I am, Your Honor. The defense believes that the pony who broke into Carousel Boutique was none other than... Silver Spilled!
No!
Objection!
Defense, that is absurd. Have you forgotten a key element to that whole affair?
A key element, Prosecutor Luna?
Carousel Boutique was completely locked up. All the windows, all the doors. There'd be no way for an earth pony like Miss Silverspoon to get inside. Not unless she had an accomplice, such as a unicorn, to teleport her. And who would do that for her?
That's what we thought, too. But what if we've all been wrong about that?
Wrong?
We've all been assuming that the boutique was fully locked up. We know that it was after the crime, but we don't know for sure if it was locked up before. It is quite possible that the true perpetrator had already entered and only locked up the place when they were leaving.
That is still speculation, Golden Pixie.
Maybe not, Prosecutor Luna. Has any pony taken a look at the front door's lock?
The front door's lock? What about it?
It's not an ordinary kind of lock. It's specifically a thumb-turned cylinder lock. The way it works is that it can be locked from the inside while the door's open, and then the door can close behind someone as they leave. Let's say that I'm right then, that the culprit did lock the place only when they were leaving. They'd be able to thanks to this thumb-turn lock. In doing so, they'd create the illusion that Carousel Boutique had been broken into while it had actually been already locked up completely.
Preposterous! In order for that to work, Defense, some pony would have to leave one of the entrances to the boutique unlocked for the perpetrator to enter at all. But Miss Rarity already told the police that she'd locked up the place before she headed to yesterday's trial. so there was no pony else around to unlock it.
No pony else? I'm not sure about that, Prosecutor Luna. There was, in fact, one pony who could have done that deed. They'd be the one to have orchestrated this elaborate illusion for us all to see. And they'd have done it so that Miss Silverspoon could have entered the boutique unhindered.
Then, who is this mysterious pony, Miss Cykes?
It was the only other pony who'd been with Rarity that very same day. Sweetie Belle!
Sweetie?
Sweetie Belle!
Here's how I think the whole incident happened. Before Sweetie Belle left with Rarity for yesterday's trial, she left one of the boutique's entrances unlocked. She then would have told Silver Spoon about the unlocked entrance, telling her to break in that way.
But when could she have told her that?
It would have been yesterday, just before the trial for Scootaloo and Turning Page began. They were both already at the courtroom, after all. Sweetie Belle had been brought by Rarity, and Silver Spoon and Diamond Tiara had been summoned by you, Prosecutor Luna.
I think I get what you mean, Athena. And I'm even pretty sure I know how the opportunity to talk to Silver Spoon could have arisen.
You do?
Yes. You see, Your Honor, that morning, right before the trial began, there was a pretty big argument between the three Cutie Mark Crusaders. Afterwards, Sweetie Belle ran off. She could have used that moment to search for Silver Spoon and share her plan.
A plan which would involve breaking into Carousel Boutique.
But why would she need some pony to break in the first place?
The only reason I can think of is that Sweetie Belle needed something inside that she couldn't get while she was with Rarity. So, Silver Spoon entered via the open entrance. She must have locked it behind her to avoid being caught. After some time, she must have found whatever she was looking for and began to leave. But that was when she was attacked by Rarity's cat, Opalescence. She drew blood, forcing Silver Spoon to get away by going through the front door. And as she was leaving, she engaged the thumb turn lock and closed the door behind her. That locked up the boutique completely and created the illusion that it had always been locked.
No! No, that's not true! I was never near Carousel Boutique! I never talked to Sweetie Belle!
Yet you were bleeding when you went into Diamond Tiara's house. All we need to do is find the area on you where you'd been bleeding and test the blood against the blood found in the boutique. But you and I both know that won't be necessary, Silver Spoon. There's no point in hiding it. Admit it! You were the one who broke into Carousel Boutique yesterday!
I... Okay. Okay, yeah, I admit it. It was me. Before I went to Diamond Tiara's house, I broke into Carousel Boutique.
Silver Spoon!
But why? What were you looking for in the boutique?
It was the magazine, wasn't it? Diamond Tiara said you brought it to our house yesterday. You must have gone to the boutique in order to retrieve it. We might not know that for certain, but I think it'd be easy enough to check.
That's true. We could ask Rarity to see if the magazines belong to her. We could even search the boutique again to see if there's any evidence to show that a magazine had gone missing.
Yes, it would be simple. But to break into the boutique all for a magazine?
It's not so innocuous, Your Honor. Have you forgotten why we started down this path in the first place? That magazine has some of its pages cut. Some magazine cuttings were found in the anonymous tip that implicated Turning Page. Those cuttings match the ones found in the magazine. And that means... Miss Cykes.
Yes, Prosecutor Luna?
Whoa. She looks... tired.
This is the conclusion you'd come to before, isn't it?
It is.
Then, perhaps you had best tell the court.
Tell the court what exactly?
Thank you for trusting in me, Prosecutor Luna. I know it couldn't have been easy. Your Honor, now that we have confirmed all of this,
We now know the true identity of the pony who sent that anonymous tip. It was whoever owned that magazine and could cut it up. That can only be Sweetie Belle herself.
What? Me?
But that's not all. Now that we know that, we can also figure out why she asked Silver Spoon to break into Carousel Boutique to retrieve that magazine. Sweetie Belle did not want it known that she wrote the anonymous tip. So, she needed to pin the blame on some pony else by implicating them through underhanded means. As the court will recall, when I first brought out this magazine and said it had been found in Diamond Tiara's home, it was believed she was the true sender of the tip. But that was all a ruse orchestrated by Sweetie Belle. She had Silver Spoon steal the magazine from Carousel Boutique and plant it in Diamond Tiara's bedroom.
But that still doesn't mean I wrote it! Or heck, that I even sent it! How'd I be able to do that, huh? I can't just walk up to the police station and leave it there! All the officers would see me! If I did send that tip, how could I have delivered it?
That's a fair point. She wouldn't have had an opportunity to send it by traditional means.
Exactly!
Could Sugar Stamp have helped in any way?
No. After all, she'd have no way of making the tip. She wasn't the one who had the magazines. Sweetie Belle was. But if she couldn't have sent it traditionally, what if there was a way to send it in a non-traditional manner?
Non-traditional. No, you don't mean.
Huh? Hold on a second. Where are Fluttershy, Pinkie Pie, and Spike?
Spike headed out just after you guys left for the detention center.
I asked him to go check in on Sweetie Belle for me. I suppose he must still be with her.
It's the only way that it makes sense, Twilight.
Defense? Have you found an answer?
We have, Your Honor.
You have?
Your Honor, at the time that the tip was sent on the 13th, Rarity had sent my friend Spike to check up on Sweetie Belle, who had said she hadn't been feeling that well. Spike is a baby dragon, and he has a special ability. He can send letters via his magic fire breath.
Oh, so I see.
Yep. He stayed here way too long for him to not even bat an eye at that.
Miss Sparkle, you're saying that when Spike went up to check on Sweetie Belle, she could have asked him to send that tip to the police station?
That's right. And she could have asked him to do it, and to keep it a secret. Spike would have trusted that she'd have good reason for asking it to be kept quiet. But now...
Whether or not he knew the thing he was sending was an anonymous tip implicating Turning Page, Spike still sent it anyway. That's how it was delivered without any pony seeing who sent it.
But wait a minute! You also said that I got Silver Spoon to get that magazine back in order to free Diamond Tiara! But why would Silver Spoon do that to her best friend?
Yeah, why?
I suspect it has to do with what happened in the woods the night of Royal Order's murder. If Silver Spoon really helped Sweetie Belle when she was hurt, that also means she was the one who went to Zecora's hut to steal a healing potion. I think, using that information against her, Sweetie Belle could have persuaded Silver Spoon into helping enact her plan.
That only holds up if Silver Spoon really did help me that night! And there's no proof she did!
You're right in saying there's no proof she did help you. But there's an easy way of determining that once and for all.
There is?
In the previous trial, we learned that both Diamond Tiara and Silver Spoon had blood on their hooves. We thought it belonged to Royal Order, but Silver Spoon confessed before we could verify that. Yet, today, Silver Spoon admitted that, instead of joining Diamond Tiara in the gorge, she chased after Scootaloo and Turning Page. Diamond Tiara still got her hooves bloody by touching the body. But somehow, so did Silver Spoon. So how did her hooves get bloody if she hadn't touched the body? And whose blood did it belong to?
No.
That blood could only belong to Sweetie Belle. Silver Spoon's hooves got covered in it when she helped make the tourniquet. All we need to do is conduct one final blood test. And then we'd know for certain
that Silver Spoon did help her that night, and that would confirm everything else. The sending of the anonymous tip, the break-in at Carousel Boutique, and the framing of Diamond Tiara. It was all planned and orchestrated by Sweetie Belle!
Sweetie Belle? All that the defense has claimed has been laid out in full. The only thing left is for you to confirm everything. I know you're scared. I know you want to run. But there can be no more running, not from this. You must face the truth once and for all. Please. Think of your sister, who no doubt sits in the gallery worried out of her mind. Think of your friends. This whole affair must surely come to a shock to all of them. You will no doubt have to face their reactions once outside of this courtroom. The time for reparations will occur then. But for now, you must tell us.
What really happened that night? That goes for you too, Silver Spoon.
Me?
I know that night was traumatic for both of you, but we have a chance to confront it. Please, tell us what happened.
Okay, Athena. That night was the scariest night of my life. I really thought after that Timberwolf attacked me, I wouldn't make it out. That I'd die alone in that dumb forest.
You thought you'd die? Just how severe was your injury?
My leg had nearly been ripped off. I guess the Timberwolf had gone crazy after it ate Royal Order's body. Like it was drunk with blood or something. I could barely stay conscious long enough to get behind the statue.
That was when I showed up. DTA told me to chase after Scootaloo and Turning Page, but I never found them. What I did find, however, was blood on the crossroads. I thought one of them had gotten hurt, so I followed it to its source. It led me to the statue, but there wasn't any pony there. I was about to leave when I heard what sounded like moaning coming from behind the statue. I was already scared by everything that happened, but I couldn't help being curious and, well, I went to look behind the statue. What I found was Sweetie Belle. She was in a very bad state. I remember calling out to her, too shocked to do anything else. She didn't respond, just made another moan, one that sounded weaker than the last.
And that was when you decided to help her?
I couldn't just let her bleed out there. My parents work at a hospital. They understand the value of pony life. Even though they aren't around a whole lot, they still taught me the importance of all lives, too.
Using, I assume, what medical knowledge you do have, you managed to scrape together the forest debris to fashion this tourniquet, thus allowing you to stop the bleeding.
Yeah, and I stayed there, by Sweetie Belle's side, until she regained consciousness.
When I awoke, I felt fuzzy and disoriented, so I didn't recognize who was next to me. But then I realized it was Silver Spoon. I was shocked. I tried asking her why she was there, but all she did was ask me questions about how I was feeling. Then she asked if I could walk. I looked at my leg and saw the tourniquet, and when I stood, I found I could move a little.
The tourniquet wouldn't hold forever, though, and Sweetie Belle's wounds were bad. She needed to get to a hospital, but we were too deep in the Everfree Forest to get there in time. I asked if she had any ideas to what we should do, and she said she knew a place that had a healing potion we could use to fix her leg. You mean Sakura's hut?
Uh-huh. We walked there together and knocked on her door, but there wasn't any pony home. So Silver Spoon went inside to grab the potion herself.
I don't know what Sakura puts in that stuff, but it managed to seal the wound almost immediately, and I could walk without it hurting. It did itch for a while afterwards, though.
You two then made your way out of the Everfree Forest afterwards?
Yeah. I also saw Sweetie Belle home so that she didn't have to walk alone. We started talking.
About what?
My friendship with Diamond Tiara. I'm kinda jealous of you three.
Us three? You mean me, Applebloom, and Scootaloo? Why?
Because you all seem so close. You get to have fun with each other all the time.
Well, yeah. That's because we're friends. Don't you get to do that sort of thing with Diamond Tiara?
Please don't ever tell Diamond Tiara what I'm about to tell you. Promise me.
All right.
I don't really think DT and I are friends like you three are. We definitely don't get along like you girls do. Sometimes I think it's because we're really just filling in gaps that our parents left for us. Diamond Tiara's parents are... them. And mine aren't ever around.
That's... really sad, Silver Spoon. How'd you two even meet?
At a party. Something that the riches threw, and that my parents and I were invited to. Of course, when we went, my parents left me to go talk to other ponies. But that was when I met Diamond Tiara. Because we were the same age, we really hit it off. And for a while, I thought that was all right, you know? I thought that was what I wanted out of a friendship. But now I see how you act around Scootaloo and Applebloom. How you're always smiling and laughing. And it makes me feel less happy with whatever I have with DT. Like I realize I've been missing something.
If that's the case, then why don't you just say you don't want to be friends with her anymore?
Because I'm scared that if I do, I won't have anyone else to talk to. Or that no one will want to talk to me.
Silver Spoon, I have to ask. Did you take part in that blackmailing? Did you steal our stuff and leave that letter for us to find?
I did.
You shouldn't have done that, Silver Spoon. No pony wants to be friends with a blackmailer.
I know that. I'm sorry.
Thank you for helping me out, though.
You're welcome, Sweetie Belle. Actually, I don't know if I have any right to ask this, but, do you think you'd ever want to hang out? Guess not. Can't say I blame her, though.
The next day, I was still at home trying to recover from my injury when I heard from Rarity that Scootaloo had been arrested.
That's also when we learned from Rarity that you were feeling sick. I remember you weren't that cooperative when we went to talk to you.
I know. I'm sorry, Princess Twilight, but I was really worried. I mean, I knew that the murder had occurred at the statue, but I'd been there too. My blood was at the scene. I was afraid I'd be arrested. That's why I didn't want to help. But even so, I couldn't just sit by and let Scootaloo suffer. So after you and the others left, I decided to write that anonymous tip.
Saying that Turning Page had killed his father in the Everfree Forest?
Yep. But at first, I didn't really want to go through with it. It wasn't until Spike showed up to check on me that I decided to have it sent anyway. He asked me what it was, but I told him to trust me, that it wasn't anything bad. I also told him that if he did this, I'd send him up on a date with Rarity.
Sweetie Belle, that's incredibly manipulative of you.
I know that! But I had to do it when I had the courage. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to. Not that it ended up working out anyway. Turning Page getting accused didn't get Scootaloo acquitted. If anything, it just made the whole situation worse for the two of them. I also knew that at some point, I'd be found out. And I couldn't bear to face Scootaloo if she learned what I did to Turning, knowing how she feels. So that's when I decided to try and plant the magazine in Diamond Tiara's home. That way, Scootaloo would think she sent it, not me.
I sense that was not the only reason, however.
No. I did it too because I wanted to get back at Diamond Tiara for what she did to us.
But even then, you couldn't actually plant the magazine yourself. Rarity forced you to come to the trial.
I was even more afraid then. I thought for sure I'd be arrested. So I needed a way to make sure I wasn't on any pony's radar.
And that must have led to you leaving one of the entrances to the boutique unlocked.
Right. The back door one. While Rarity was preparing to leave, I thought about how I could get this plan to work and realized I'd have to rely on Silverspoon. I had a feeling she and Diamond Tiara would show up during the trial once the blackmail was uncovered, so I was sure I'd be able to find her then.
That would have been right after the fight you had in the lobby before the trial.
It wasn't hard to find her. She was in the witness lobby waiting to be summoned. I figured that whatever happened during the trial, she and Diamond would get off thanks to their families. Which meant she'd be available to help me after the trial, which was what my plan needed to happen. I managed to get her away from Diamond Tiara to talk to her alone, and that was when I told her my plan. But
I didn't want to do it. She was asking me to break into some pony's house and steal something for Celestia's sake. Even if it was with her permission, it was out of the question.
I tried to convince her that it wasn't worth staying attached to Diamond's hip when she was about to sink. I even brought up what she said in the previous night, but Silverspoon wouldn't budge, no matter what I said.
So that's when you had to play a different card.
Yeah. I demanded that Silverspoon do what I asked, or I'd tell Diamond what she told me, and Sakura about the potions she stole.
You blackmailed her.
That potion! I only learned later that it was in high demand at the hospital. If my parents learned that I'd stolen and used it, they'd be furious. So I had no choice. I said I'd do what she'd asked.
In the end, what I was afraid of did happen. I was found out and arrested. But my plan still worked. Silverspoon wasn't detained for long and made her way to the boutique to steal the magazine.
It was just like you described, Athena. I entered through the unlocked entrance and found the magazine. But then I got attacked by Opalescence, and she scratched me a little. I managed to get away through the front door, engaging the lock before it closed. Afterwards, I went to DT's house to place the magazine in the trash. That was just a few minutes before you all arrived.
But that's everything. Everything Silverspoon did. Everything I did. Everything.
There is some tragic irony in all of this, Sweetie Belle, which I do not think you have realized.
Tragic irony?
These actions you took, don't they seem quite familiar to you?
Blackmail, framing, subterfuge, lying. They're nearly the same actions Diamond Tiara took against you, your friends, and Turning Page. In trying to stop what she was doing, you ended up doing what she did anyway.
The meek little prey became the vicious predator, biting back with vengeance.
You're right. You're completely right. What have I done?
Witnesses, you may step down from the stand now.
Yes, Your Honor.
Miss Cykes.
Yes, Prosecutor Luna?
It appears we have come to an end of the winding trail you set us upon. We have managed to uncover a great deal of revelations, and with them some complicated feelings, I am sure. Much has been said now about what happened following this murder, and we have managed, I believe, to piece together a fuller picture of the actions many took these past few days. But this discovery, this confession, these revelations, what were they all for?
What were they all for?
Indeed. In perhaps an equally tragically ironic sense, we have learned much about everything around the murder, but very little about the murder itself.
I must agree. For as cathartic as this confession was, has it led us to uncovering anything further about the true nature of Royal Order's murder?
I think we have at least uncovered one thing. You noticed it as well, Athena?
I did, Twilight.
Really?
Your Honor, what we just heard from Silver Spoon and Sweetie Belle doesn't just reveal to us their part in all of this. It also reveals a huge contradiction.
And just what would this huge contradiction be?
Let me show you. Silver Spoon said that she had followed after Turning Page in Scootaloo, right? She went down the crossroads before she ended up at the statue. Now, we know that she went there before Royal Order's body ended up near the castle ruins. That tells us that she must have been chasing them around the same time that Sugar Stamp was flying over.
You're saying...
Precisely. Sugar Stamp told us that when she was flying over the path, she saw two ponies heading towards each other. One was Decora, and the other was Turning Page. But she never mentioned seeing Silver Spoon or any pony else on the path. How could she have missed her? But neither Decora nor Turning Page.
Aha! That is quite the contradiction, isn't it?
So Miss Sugar Stamp's confession contradicts Silver Spoon's. How do you explain that, Miss Cykes? Was Silver Spoon lying?
I don't think so, no. Too many of her events match up with our evidence. That leaves us with Sugar Stamp's confession. It's far more likely she's the one lying about who she saw.
We also know, from what Private Eye confessed to, that the murder weapon was fabricated, too. Her entire confession and testimony must be false.
Furthermore, the fact that Private Eye went out of his way to fabricate such evidence tells us he did so in order to support her entire confession.
Her entire confession? You mean not just the murder, but also...
Right, Your Honor. Her moving the body is also a fabrication. In other words, everything that Sugar Stamp allegedly confessed to, murdering Royal Order at the clearing, moving his body, and framing Turning Page and Scootaloo, is nothing but a carefully crafted lie.
Objection!
So you return to that claim yet again, Miss Cykes. Yet I am not sure that Sugar Stamp and Private Eye were in cahoots over this. But even if I were convinced, surely even you can see how what you've proposed puts us all in a difficult situation.
Difficult? How so, Prosecutor Luna?
Your Honor, if the defense is right, that the body at the clearing was neither moved nor killed by Sugar Stamp, then what actually did happen? For regardless of what did happen, one thing remains certain. The body was still moved.
Yes, indeed. I would like to know what the defense thinks.
Okay, Athena. Everything's finally come to this point. I need to take a moment and think this through one step at a time. If I'm right about this, then we have no explanation for how the body was moved. But maybe I need to change my thinking here. Instead of focusing on how to explain the body being moved, maybe I should focus on why the body needed to be moved in the first place. Sugar Stamp and Private Eye were working together to falsify the events that happened at the clearing, so whatever they produced cannot be trusted. Taking that into consideration, what do we have that we know can be trusted definitively? What can tell us what happened in that clearing?
Of course! Sonata found blood at the clearing. Private was in court during the blood's discovery, so there's no way he could have faked a blood test for it. That means that this really is Royal Order's blood. But what does that tell us? All we could really say is that a big pool of his blood was there at the scene. Is there anything that could point to where it came from? That's right. The blood rings belong to Royal Order too. They didn't end up there when he died, so some pony else had to have splashed his blood. And when they did so, they must have splashed the blood in the direction of the clearing. Yet somehow, no one reported this blood being found on the ground. How could the blood have gotten only onto the trees, and formed in such a weird way? What if... That's it! If the blood was moved from one place to another using unicorn levitation, then it would likely form the rings around the trees! Then that suggests that the blood found at the clearing came from the blood at the statue, which would mean there was never a murder at the clearing to begin with, only at the statue. But that means... No clone? So that means this entire time, we've been chasing after a ruse? This is somehow even more insane than the clone theory itself! I hate having to backpedal on things like this! But it's the only thing that can explain everything we've uncovered. Even so, our entire position was built on that theory. Now I know it's wrong. But who could have set this whole thing in motion? And why?
Athena? What's wrong? You look like you're about to throw up!
Twilight, I just figured something out.
Great! Does it help us?
I think so, but it also doesn't?
Huh?
Miss Cykes, I believe we've waited long enough. Prosecutor Luna has asked for an explanation, and the court would very much appreciate hearing it.
I don't know how to feel about this. I think I'm on the right track here, but...
Athena?
Huh?
What you figured out, do you think it'll help us find the truth?
Yeah, but... it's...
Then we have to tell the court, no matter what. Even if it might hurt us now, if it takes us even one step closer, we have to take that leap.
I know I've been asking this a lot, Twilight, but... are you with me?
Always, and to the very end.
Miss Cykes, I sense that whatever it is you are about to tell the court is causing you some amount of discomfort. Nonetheless, you cannot relent. You've demonstrated a tremendous level of both faith and ingenuity while defending your clients. What you need now is resolve. The necessary resolve to stand tall and go forward with your beliefs, and prove to me that I was not mistaken in mine about trusting you. Is this something you can muster?
Yes, I think so. So, first, let me ask you something. You still believe that there were two royal orders that night, correct?
Yes. The two bloodstains found at the clearing and the statue prove that two royal orders were in the Everfree Forest.
They do, if we take those stains at face value.
What are you talking about?
Here's the thing, Prosecutor Luna. Ever since the previous trial, we all believed that clones were involved. Royal Order went to the mirror pool in order to clone himself.
Yes, that was your reasoning. Defense, where are you going with this?
But now, when we take into account at least one of those areas where the blood was found was part of the phony confession, our initial theory gets placed under a new light.
Athena, you don't mean...
Here goes. Prosecutor Luna, Your Honor, Twilight, I believe that despite everything we've heard, despite everything we've supposedly uncovered, the fact of the matter is that this clone never existed in the first place.
What?
He's still! Golden Pixie, have you taken leave of your senses? The existence and subsequent involvement of a clone was your postulation to begin with!
Indeed, Miss Cykes! How is it that now of all times, you decide to abandon that theory altogether?
No! Athena, you can't seriously think... I mean, when I considered all of the possibilities, I couldn't have anticipated this!
Me neither. But please, just hear me out. I know that was what we were arguing before, but I just now realized our line of thinking was completely wrong.
How could it be? You provided a perfectly sound explanation as to how clones, as absurd as the idea initially was, could be involved with the murder.
That's just it. I think the explanation was too perfect.
Explain, Defense.
Here's what I think. When Twilight and I proposed the clone theory, Private Eye had been listening and told Sugar Stamp about it after the trial. They must have used that idea to create this false narrative about a clone.
You mean they didn't plan this from the start?
I don't think so. No one thought of clones until we brought it up. And then, afterwards, everything began lining up with Sugar Stamp's confession.
But why would they do this? Why would they go so far just to create the illusion of there being clones involved?
I'm not sure, to be honest.
Then I must reject this madness outright. You know such speculation is not permitted in this court. I thought I could rely on you to abide by that, at least. You need proof, and I demand you show it to us immediately.
Proof that there were no clones. How can I show that?
This is what you meant before, when you said this could both help and not help us.
I know it throws everything we've been arguing out the window, Twilight, but...
No, I... see the logic in it. Admittedly, it's a bit simplistic in scope, but they do say that sometimes the simplest answer is the right one. In which case, I think this might actually be the truth.
You do? But then, how do we prove it?
Let me think. So, the clone story was fabricated entirely, correct?
That's right.
Well, if the clones themselves weren't real, then something else about them must not be real too. Like the circumstances around their creation, maybe.
The circumstances?
But we'd have to somehow show those circumstances aren't real either. But short of time traveling back to the moment the clones were supposedly created, which incidentally is now impossible to do...
Ah! I've got it! I know how to show that.
You do?
Yep. Thanks, Twilight. Okay. You want proof, Prosecutor Luna? You got it! Take that!
A photo of the mirror pool's entrance? How is this proof?
Look closer. On the boulder itself, you can see a particular species of flower partly growing. These are day bloomers. True to their name, they only bloom during the day. But that's not all. If you look at the vines on the flowers themselves, you can see that they've been cut. If Royal Order had moved the boulder on the night of the murder in order to access the mirror pool, then the flowers shouldn't have blossomed in the following days. Yet, when my friends and I arrived at the scene, they were all blooming. This could only mean that some pony moved that rock in the middle of the day. Perhaps even recently. Possibly right after the previous trial and after we presented our clone theory.
That certainly makes an alarming amount of sense.
But who could have moved the boulder then?
There was only one pony who'd be able to do that. Private Eye.
Private Eye? How?
When we were investigating the mirror pool yesterday, Private Eye let it slip that he was the first of his team to come across the boulder.
When I first found the cave, it was already open like this.
Because of that, he'd be able to make it look like the boulder had already been moved by royal order.
Objection!
This doesn't prove there were no clones, though.
How come?
Because of how you and Miss Cykes determined definitely that there was a clone that night. The royal order whose body was found near the castle ruins died instantly from a wound to the head. But as we learned yesterday, Scootaloo crashed into another royal order while fleeing the forest. A royal order who happened, as she testified, to still be breathing. How else can you explain one body breathing and one body not breathing if not by admitting the existence of a clone? Furthermore, the body found in the ruins doesn't bear any signs of a scooter crashing into it. Just a large bruise on the side of the abdomen. Once again, how else can you explain this absence of obvious distinct bruising if not by admitting the existence of a clone? It doesn't make any sense.
You're right. It doesn't make any sense.
What? You admit it?
What we'd established before proved clones were involved, and our strongest evidence was Scootaloo hearing breathing from the body she crashed into. But if clones were not involved, then what Scootaloo thought she heard must have been wrong.
You don't mean to say...
that the breathing Scootaloo thought she heard coming from Royal Order didn't come from him. Instead, it must have come from some pony else.
But Miss Scootaloo was so certain she heard it coming directly from Royal Order!
Then logically, it must have come from some pony who was right up against the body itself.
Objection!
That claim is ridiculous! How on Equestria could Scootaloo have missed seeing some pony behind the body?
Well, it was quite dark.
Even so, if the moon was bright enough that Scootaloo could see she crashed into Royal Order, then she would have seen some pony behind him. There is no feasible way for any pony to hide that way, and thus no way for her to have heard any pony but Royal Order breathing. Nothing short of a child could have even the slightest chance.
Child? No, that's ridiculous. There wasn't any pony like that who would have had a chance to... Oh, no.
Athena? What is it this time?
Maybe I'm wrong. I've gotta be. But all my instincts are telling me, screaming at me.
Miss Cykes? Do you need me to call a recess? You appear... ill.
I do? I'm not. I... But... Prosecutor Luna?
Hmm? What... What is it, Miss Cykes?
Before I answer your rebuttal, I want to confirm two more things by asking Silver Spoon and Sweetie Belle to retake the stand.
Miss Cykes, I'm not sure what you're planning now, but... Very well. The prosecution won't object to this.
Your Honor?
yes, quite right. The court accepts this proposal.
Athena?
Silver Spoon? When you were chasing after Scootaloo and turning page, you were headed towards the crossroads, right?
Yeah, that was before I found Sweetie Belle.
Previously, Zecora testified that she was headed towards the castle. She would have been on the same road as you were. Before you found Sweetie Belle, did you ever run into Zecora?
Run into? No, actually, I just saw her coming and hid.
You hid?
Yeah, I just jumped away into the forest so that she wouldn't see me.
What?
But that must mean you were the shadowy figure Zecora saw leap out of her way?
That can't be right. Turning Page said he was the one whom Zecora saw.
But Zecora never got a good look at that figure. All she could tell was that it was a child. And think about what we figured out just now, too. About Sugar Stamp's story.
She couldn't have missed seeing Silver Spoon if she saw both Sakura and Turning Page. But that was a lie, wasn't it? Just like the rest of her confession.
Right. But that leaves us with a missing bit of information. Sugar Stamp's story initially told us where Turning Page was after the blackmail deal went bad. But now that it's been shown to be a lie, and that neither Silver Spoon nor Sakura saw him, the question becomes, where did Turning Page actually go?
Indeed. His disappearance cannot be accounted for.
Huh? Miss Cykes?
Keep it together, Athena. Sweetie Belle.
Huh? What is it, Athena?
That tip you sent. We've established you sent it, and how, but there's still something left unanswered. Why Turning Page? You could have implicated Diamond Tiara or even Silver Spoon, since you knew they'd been blackmailing you and your friends. But why specifically him?
It's because of what I overheard when I was hiding behind the statue before I passed out.
What did you hear?
Exactly what I wrote on the anonymous tip, Princess Twilight.
What you wrote?
I thought if I wrote that, it would be enough to save Scootaloo. Even though it'd make her really, really sad.
Thank you. Both of you. And there it is. The last detail I needed. The last detail I actually wanted.
So you've confirmed those two things you were looking for, Miss Cykes. But what now?
Can I do this? I don't know if I can. Or if I even want to. I don't think I've ever wanted to be proven more wrong in my entire life. And yet, all the pieces of this ugly, frustrating, terrible puzzle have finally come together to form the complete, tragic picture. All I have to do is put it together. But if I do that, Sun Pony's innocence would be destroyed. And what's more important than protecting that?
There is one thing even more important than the trial's outcome. The truth.
You're right, boss. I have to do this. Prosecutor Luna? Your Honor? Twilight?
What is it, Miss Cykes?
Thanks to what we've just heard, I've figured it out. The answer to the question that's been at the center of everything.
You mean the question of who killed Royal Order?
Who? There's only one pony who could have. And that's the son of the victim himself.
Turning Page!
What?
You can't be serious! Why would you even think that?
As much as I don't want to believe it, it's the only explanation left. And the one that clears up these last and final contradictions.
These contradictions? You mean the breathing and lack of bruising?
Yes, Your Honor. That breathing could not have come from the victim himself, but instead, Sun Pony sitting right up against him. As Prosecutor Luna pointed out, they'd have to be small as a child.
No!
That night, there were five children in the forest. Four of them,
Diamond Tiara, Silver Spoon, Scootaloo, and Sweetie Belle have all been accounted for. But as we established, the fifth, Turning Page, somehow vanished. He could only have appeared to do so if he was hidden in plain sight. By hiding next to the body of Royal Order that lay in the middle of the crossroads. Therefore, the breathing that Scootaloo heard had to come from him.
That's right! That explains it!
Then what of the lack of bruises on Royal Order?
All this time, we thought that Scootaloo had crashed into him. But now that we know Turning Page was there too, we can perfectly understand why Royal Order suffered no bruises from the scooter. It's because Scootaloo instead crashed into Turning Page himself!
Objection!
That is a completely impossible claim, Defense! Turning Page showed no signs of injury during or after the event!
Objection!
That's because we haven't searched him yet! Your Honor, the Defense formally requests that Turning be searched for signs of bruising!
No! Prosecution refuses to allow this! I will not—
It's all right, Princess Luna. If Miss Cykes wants me to be searched, then I'll allow it.
What? Turning Page, no! Don't you see what this means for you?
That's enough, Prosecutor Luna! Bailiff, search the young colt immediately for any signs of bruising. Let us see the truth once and for all. Is that...
a bruise?
On the right side.
No! This cannot be!
Your Honor! This proves that Turning Page is the one responsible for the death of—
Objection!
Fair devotion?
That's enough, Miss Cykes. I won't have you disparage my son anymore. Especially not for a crime he didn't commit.
What do you mean? The bruise tells us—
It tells us, yes, he got them from when Scootaloo crashed into him. But that's all. It says nothing about his culpability, despite what you have been arguing.
But respectfully, Miss Devotion, Turning Page, having submitted himself for examination, has indicated his guilt.
That is only because his father raised him to take responsibility, even for the things he has no control over. Your Honor, my son didn't kill my husband. I did.
What? You what? Court! Miss Devotion! You confess to murdering your husband?
That's impossible! You just testified earlier that you didn't even find Royal Order until it was too late!
And I still stand by the majority of my testimony, but I must make one additional statement.
One additional statement?
Sugarstamp said that she saw Sweetie Belle attack Royal Order, but that was a lie. In actuality, the pony who attacked him, leading to him being impaled at the statue's base, was me.
No! That's not true! She's only doing this to protect her son!
I see. Well, as this runs counter to your argument, what do you think, Miss Cykes?
Your Honor, the defense opposes accepting this new confession!
What?
On what grounds?
On the grounds that it muddles everything! We can't just take this at face value! If we want to reach a satisfying conclusion to this whole case, we need to hear one final testimony from Miss Devotion!
Athena's right, Your Honor. There's no way to determine if we can trust this confession until we hear exactly what Fair Devotion did that night.
Prosecutor Luna, do you have any objections?
Please, Prosecutor Luna!
I... No, Your Honor. I do not. The prosecution would also like to hear this final testimony. From this final witness. For the final time.
Very well. The court accepts the proposal. Miss Devotion, you will testify as to what happened between you and Royal Order on the night of his murder. Is that understood?
Very well, Your Honor.
This is it. With this, we'll finally be able to put an end to this ordeal. The truth is out in the open now. And all that's left to shield it is one final testimony from Miss Devotion.
Together we can see all the things that yet to be. And if your heart can't go on this way, remember what I'd say. Hundreds of years away.